If you've spent enough time with me, you know two things when it comes to my taste in movies. One, I adore movies in general, provided they're well written. Two, Baz Luhrmann movies are a tough watch for me. This may seem as if I dislike Baz Luhrmann's work, which would be understandable, but not the full story. What gets me about Luhrmann's movies is his nauseating directing style, which seems to reach an extreme in his 2001 film Moulin Rouge. The spinning cameras, the extreme zollies, the hundreds of cuts a minute, the anachronism of both his choice in music and costume. I'm looking at you, tight lace corsets on bare skin. Well, I don't doubt for a second that this is intentional and symbolic. I just get easily overwhelmed by it all. Wes Anderson, on the other hand, is one of my favorite directors of all time. I enjoy the soft spring and autumn color palettes, the timeless music, the dioramics and symmetrical framing, and the intentional mistakes sprinkled throughout each film. Admittedly, Anderson and Luhrmann, like all directors, share a decent amount of directing conventions, those of symmetry and color in particular. I also believe, however, that each director's use of framing and lighting play key factors in splitting Anderson from Luhrmann. Today, we'll discuss the similarities and differences in two widely acclaimed directors, aka I'm gonna analyze one and gush about the other. We'll analyze and compare key scenes from each director's notable films, Moulin Rouge and The Great Gatsby from Baz Luhrmann versus Fantastic Mr. Fox and The Grand Budapest Hotel from Wes Anderson. I would do Asteroid City if I had the opportunity, but it doesn't release in theaters until the day before this assessment is due. Regardless, this video is going to be long. We're already, what, 2 minutes in? So let's get right into the scenes. From the 2001 classic Moulin Rouge, I give you the most memorable scene in the film. At least to a theater kid. This tango is jam-packed with more cuts in 3 minutes than there might be in whole movies, adding to the violent and chaotic tone of the scene. We can actually see an example of the opposite of this through Gus Van Sant's 2003 film Elephant, but we're not here to talk about Elephant this year. Shifting back to our triple narrative music video, we can clearly see the established storylines through Luhrmann's use of color. In Moulin Rouge, Luhrmann loves using these blue and red color washes to imply specific themes throughout the film. Blue represents the harsh winter of the outside world, as well as the idea of luxury and wealth, as seen in Satine's entrance. Quick note, Satine's introduction scene includes a remix of both Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend and Material Girl by Marilyn Monroe and Madonna, respectively. While this is a clever use of parallels between Satine and both the idols she's covering, as an idealized woman often at the mercy of those who own her, the colors in Satine's entrance directly contrast with Marilyn's performance and, as Material Girl is an 80s version of the same scene from Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, Madonna's performance as well. I don't actually know why this is the case, but I'd assume it has something to do with Satine wanting to stand out from the red that already floods the Moulin Rouge. Ah, what a perfect transition into the red representing the underbelly of society! A, quote, village of sin that thrives off of those in the blue, those willing to pay for a bit of purple in their life. The Moulin Rouge and most of its workers wear red. El Tango de Roxanne refers to the red lights commonly associated with sex workers. Satine, the sparkling diamond herself, has red hair and wears bright red lipstick. Not only this, but red also seems to represent the fantastical idea of living in a world like the Moulin Rouge, where everything is free and artistic, if not done out of necessity. Let's recap. Blue represents reality and luxury, while red represents fantasy and sin. In this tango, these colors are used to show three different narratives. One, Satine's dinner with the Duke in blue, as her attempt to become a real actress. Two, the dramatic performance of Roxanne in the Moulin Rouge, flush with red. And three, Christian's indecision between the two, at one point being shown in both red and blue light. This is quite clever, as it's assumed Christian himself doesn't want to be in either situation. Rather, he'd create his own story with Satine away from the red and blue, perhaps in a warm light. However, he has no choice in the matter. It's one or the other. He is in both situations as much as he believes he is in neither. Now, I know I've been rambling about color for the last however many minutes, the last 5 minutes, but the real star of the show in this music video is, in fact, the music. El Tango de Roxanne, that's so hard to say without a Spanish accent, is, I believe, an original song from Lorman, which is Christian's part, and a dramatic cover of the 1978 song Roxanne by The Police, a song about
a prostitute and a man who falls in love.
Just like Christian's current situation with Satine. Something I particularly enjoy about this song choice is the color symbolism. No, we're not done talking about color yet. One of the most memorable lines in Roxanne is
Roxanne, you don't have to put on that red light.
In reference to red lights or scarves being a symbol indicating sex workers, which pairs perfectly with the Moulin Rouge itself. Always in red light, the Moulin Rouge is somewhere men usually flock to when wanting to hire a sex worker. Christian, on the other hand, is the only person inside the Moulin Rouge at the time that refuses to actively take part in the tango. Instead, he leads his own part, sings his own song, separate from Roxanne. He's the sole artist with a dream in a literal circus full of laborers that have watched men like him fall down the same ravine. This could perhaps be used to indicate the illusion of free choice, though both Christian's song and the scene are overwhelmed by Roxanne and her red light as he tries to flee. Christian is outnumbered and outmatched by the light, dramatic music, and an army of dancers prophesying his fate. Prophesying? I don't know how to say that. So overall, we have music, mise-en-scene, and the frantic editing of El Tango de Roxanne, screaming the chaotic ballad of a conflict of interests in which one acts as the prophecy of our doomed protagonist, while the other represents his fleeting dream, an ideal fantasy. The scene is the peak of the tsunami, the strongest winds of the cyclone, the brightest strike of lightning, the loudest clap of thunder. Roxanne, Satine, is the epicenter of the Moulin Rouge, and Christian has been lured into it.
Old sport.
Enough of the conflict. It's time for a party. A grand party, a great party, a Gatsby party. Welcome to the first two parties our protagonist Nick Carraway attends in The Great Gatsby, Baz Luhrmann's adaptation of author F. Scott Fitzgerald's novel by the same name. When compared to the gaudy bright colors and dirty lands of the parties outside of West Egg, aka those of New York without millions of dollars to spare, Gatsby's parties are exponentially luxurious. Luhrmann takes great care in using pearly white and gold to represent the more luxurious end of New York, and dirtier yet more saturated brown and red to display the, quote, valley of ashes that New York's working class inhabits, establishing a very clear divide between the two. A similarity between them, besides Nick being present at both, is the chaotic and frantic nature of the editing paired with anachronistic music, as we've seen before in Moulin Rouge. Let's compare the first and second parties by techniques. At the first, Myrtle's party, we're set in a muted and smoky railroad area just outside of the city. The attendees wear very saturated and bold colors with matching costume jewelry. I want to emphasize the costume jewelry. The framing is intimate while we watch a small group of characters in this two-bedroom apartment, but zooms out both when Nick looks outside and when the night starts to go awry. The sound is uncomfortably busy, bordering on cacophony, but you can still absorb every word uttered by those at the party, aka the worst kind of party. The diegetic sound especially starts out joyful and descends into conflict. Part of this confusion is likely due to Nick's state of mind in the scene, considering we're experiencing his account of the events. We know Nick is blind drunk at this party and was not expecting at all to find himself where he is. Even so, the event burns bright and fast and is snuffed out by a gale force wind before it can burn out naturally. In comparison, the second party, Gatsby's, is set in the lush green estates of East Egg in Long Island, aka the rich neighborhood, which already creates a massive divide between the two parties. The attendees of Gatsby's party are draped in luxurious and embellished outfits in timeless shades of black, white, and gold. Their accessories are sparkling and dainty, not costumey. The framing at this party is also intimate, but the venue is large and crowded with hundreds of people, giving a sense of intimacy within chaos, rather than the other way around. The camera can zoom out as much as it wants, but the frame will still be bustling with activity. The sound is busy, but it's that kind of busy where music plays on top of everlasting conversation. You might catch a sentence or two from a few gossiping groups before they fade into general noise to the party, but ultimately it's just noise. Our protagonist is also incredibly inebriated in this scene, but actively chose his state of being while also seemingly being supported by those around him rather than being enabled, if that makes any sense. This event burns steady, even being fed at some points, and burns out naturally as the attendees tire themselves from their night of entertainment. We can clearly see Lerman's use of color, sound, setting, and more to show the difference between these two parties, but also between the two classes. Myrtle's community can easily be considered working class, proletariat, while all we see of Long Island is filled with bourgeois. New and old money is not the deciding factor here. We just have proletariat and bourgeois. We can see attempts from both at sophistication, one of which doesn't even need to try. This is, again, a reflection on hegemonic class structures, like the flushing blue and red in Moulin Rouge, the in-your-face comparison bait of costume, color, and crowding, draws the line in the sand between the survivors and the thrivers. Okay, now that we've discussed, in great detail, Baz Luhrmann style, let's get into Wes Anderson.
Granted, and the deed of entitlement is
You're not getting boy with apple, you goddamn little fruit.
How's that supposed to make me feel?
So, I've analyzed Wes Anderson before. I did a close viewing of The Royal Tenenbaums back in 2021, and the biggest lesson I learned about Wes Anderson is his style is so consistent that it is very difficult to choose a specific scene to analyze. This is made even more difficult by the fact that Anderson likes telling many stories in his movies. I mean, The French Dispatch was literally an issue of The New Yorker. Actually, French Dispatch would probably be the easiest film to analyze in terms of technique, but I both don't understand it and can't withstand another viewing at that movie. So, no, I have beef with The French Dispatch. We're not doing it. Anyway, considering we focused on a relatively climactic scene in Moulin Rouge, it seems only fair to look at something similar from the Grand Budapest Hotel, like The Final Conflict. Throughout all of his works, it's evident right off the bat that Anderson is much less intimate in his framing than Lerman. Anderson is famous for using somewhat of a flat, planar style of framing. For example, the camera only rotates horizontally by 90 or 180 degrees. Almost as if every single shot is a panel of a diorama. Anderson hardly ever deviates from this format. The most he'll allow is a slight vertical tilt. Not only this, but Anderson makes sure to create perfectly composed backgrounds, usually akin to some sort of liminal space with minimal clutter and symmetry. All the symmetry. His backgrounds are like looking into a carefully curated dollhouse. Actually, it might be closer to the experience of classical theater. Props and backgrounds put together by hand and a stage setup that clearly separates the audience from the performers, yet immerses and engages onlookers using the same techniques, plus the defined chapters of the film like intermissions. Yep, that's it. We've cracked the code! Wes Anderson is a playwright with a camera. Moving on. This framing technique in this specific scene allows for both tension and comedy in the classic Anderson style. Assisted by the rich colors of the hotel, the pastels worn by Zero and Gustave, and the parasitic shades of black worn by our antagonists throughout the hotel. The baby pink and blues worn by our protagonists in contrast to the dark shades of Dimitri and co. make it very difficult for the audience to take this scene seriously. especially when a man in a black military-style outfit is so riled up by a British man in a pink and blue chocolate seller's uniform. These contrasting colors also assist in providing visual evidence for Gustav's right to the Grand Budapest Hotel. A Demetrius dark and desaturated color scheme acts like an infection of the hotel. It's unnatural, out of place, invasive. If someone were to walk into that hotel at the time, I guarantee you they'd feel uncomfortable as soon as they step through the door. The conflicting tone is further conveyed by Anderson's decisions to cut or to pan, for instance, the 90 or 180 degree rotations versus just straight match cuts. This is very difficult to explain without just showing it to you, so here. I'd also like to mention the difference in aspect ratios used to convey time in this film. Between the 1930s, 1960s, and 1980s, three aspect ratios of 1.37 to 1, 2.39 to 1, and 1.85 to 1, respectively, were used to reflect the industry standard aspect ratios of the times. It's clever of Anderson to use the aspect ratios to emulate the experience of cinema in each time period presented in this film. It just adds that little bit of extra engagement with the audience. Oh my god, I'm already starting to feel the lash of choosing two movies from two different directors. This page is 4 of 6 of the script, and we're on minute almost 16 of recording. Prepare for a long ride. We've got two more sections left.
The cuss am I? Are you cussing with me?
No, you cussing with me?
Don't cuss and point.
You're gonna cuss with somebody. You're not gonna cuss with me, you little cuss.
We have entered the threshold of our final movie, Wes Anderson's adaptation of Roald Dahl's original novel, The Fantastic Mr. Fox? I'm pretty sure just Fantastic Mr. Fox. Anyway, confession time. I was going to pick a specific scene, but I just love this movie too much, and everything melds so well together. Because of these difficulties, I'm going to switch the structure up a bit. We'll go by technique and use shots as evidence rather than pick a scene and analyze the techniques as we go. All right, let's go. I want to start off with yet another side tangent on the specific ripples in the fur of the characters in this film, as well as Anderson's other stop motion films such as Isle of Dogs and a really short section from The French Dispatch that I don't remember was stop motion. It could have just been regular animation. I don't remember. These ripples are the result of using real fur for the animation dolls. Positioning and repositioning the characters for each frame leaves unique indents from the animator's fingers on said fur, which is commonly avoided by stop motion animators through the use of synthetic fur to maintain consistency across each shot and provide the illusion of fluidity. Anderson specifically requested the use of real fur in his stop motion movies for this exact purpose, despite the animator's suggestions against it, resulting in the now iconic ripple found in this director's signature style. This is one of my favorite parts of Wes Anderson's filmography. Every inconsistency, every mistake, every print of production that could potentially take the audience out of this world of his films is intentional if left in the cut. I adore this idea of including evidence of filmmaking into the film itself. It provides a self-aware yet relatable feel to these films. This awareness that the story is a story enables the audience to become more invested, but at the risk of alienating them completely. Similar to Anderson's use of framing. In a way, though, these details almost surrender the audience to the art of storytelling. It doesn't matter if this is fiction, it's still fun. Also, this. This is awesome. Aside from the expert framing previously mentioned, Anderson's dialogue style is as quippy and as clever as ever. Every line of dialogue is decisive and stylized. The audience knows exactly what each character's intentions are. For example, these clips.
Don't do that.
Why'd you take your shoes off?
So I don't break your nose when I kick it.
I'm sick.
You're not sick.
I have a temperature.
You don't have a temperature.
I don't want to go.
Hurry up, you're gonna be late.
I love the way you handle that.
Despite the relatively fast pace of the dialogue, the audience can still understand what's going on. I genuinely adore this kind of dialogue, as it's the kind of speech I understand most easily. I'd go into further explaining, but I'm not a psychologist, nor have I had the opportunity to explore this phenomenon with a licensed psychologist at the moment, so we'll just leave it be. The best approximation I could give to the kind of audience this dialogue resonates with is those with relatively sophisticated vocabularies and a capacity to consume a lot of information very quickly in a regulated environment, which could provide another reason towards Anderson's near monochromatic color palettes and the use of symmetry. In a way, this is the opposite of Luhrmann's approach in overwhelming the audience with background information and contrasting color palettes. Speaking of which, the journey of color in this film is quite interesting in my opinion. The progressive desaturation of the vibrant autumnal setting throughout the movie, as the Fox family travels from burrow to oak tree to sewer system, followed by a pop of white linoleum upon the discovery of the Bogus Bunsen Bean International Supermarket. If the movie were on mute, the color changes alone could give the audience a general idea of this film's story progression. One of the most iconic aspects of Fantastic Mr. Fox, by far, is the music. I'm sure it's playing in your head right now. It's very lighthearted and antique, and even the songs from other artists are vintage in tone and date. While framing might push the audience out of the atmosphere, music does the polar opposite. It doesn't matter what era the tune might be, it's a perfect match with the story. Though I am comparing the filmography of Baz Luhrmann and Wes Anderson, by no means am I saying they have the same intentions or styles. If that wasn't at least hinted to you in the past however long I've been talking at you, I've failed at my job. Luhrmann's stories, even his adapted works, are all incredibly focused on class structure and economic morality, while Anderson is very much about the art of storytelling itself and identity. Most of Anderson's original protagonists fall into similar categories. The overconfident, yet insecure, mentor or leader, the relatively innocent but aspiring student who seems to learn all the wrong lessons before finding their own footing, and the love interest. I know, but more often than not, she's still a character of her own, as well as a driving force for one of the two previous characters. As far as I can remember, the main love interest in Anderson's film has an arc or moment of her own. We can see this trio dynamic in Mr. Fox, Mrs. Fox, and Ash, Gustav, Zero, and Agatha, Royal Chaz, and Ethelene Tenenbaum, etc. By the end of Anderson's stories, each character has found happiness or contentment of some degree, providing a satisfying ending nearly every time. Naturally, there is always a third act crisis or conflict, but based on Anderson's established character archetypes, we know a master plan is on its way. Luhrmann also uses this three-character structure. The upper middle-class artist, usually a writer, the high-class lord, and the love interest. Again, the love interest is her own person, while being a driving force behind one or both of the previous. She's also trapped in her current life, usually in service to a powerful man or powerful men. We see this in Christian, the Duke and Satine, Nick, Tom and Daisy, Gatsby is a special case, Romeo, the family rivalry, and Juliet, which is a bit of a stretch, but you know, and many, many more. Most, if not all, of Luhrmann's stories end in tragedy, yet is claimed in the beginning, usually by narration. The audience walks into these films knowing something will go wrong, but Luhrmann still takes the time to build up hope throughout the narrative. He likes making us sad. Both these trends toward the same types of characters seem to reflect on the messages and natures of the directors. Luhrmann is the writer, that's why they're always the main character, and always has something to say about class systems of the world while telling stories of a hopeless romantic. Anderson is the curator. That's why his aesthetic is very stage-like. He prefers to tell stories of identity, self-discovery, and of making amends as a silent narrator. I truly believe that both Baz Luhrmann and Wes Anderson are great filmmakers. I couldn't make something remotely as close to their skill level in twice the time it would take them. The amount of time, care, and money put into these projects seeps through every crack in these movies, and I truly respect the attention to detail and use of techniques both directors use to tell their stories. The only problem is that I'm much more likely to have an overstimulation episode watching a Luhrmann film in a theater than I am watching an Anderson film in the same setting. But that's a me problem.
Oh my god, we're finally done. This ended up being way longer than I expected, but I have a dog to congratulate you for making it this far. It took me like 3 days to edit this thing. Hope you enjoyed.